When it comes to doing data analysis for a factorial design, what you're basically going to be looking at are things called main effects. There's also something called interactions, but we'll get to that in just a moment. So a main effect is the mean differences among the level of one factor. And for every factor you have in your design, there is a potential for having a main effect. So two-factor design could have two main effects. Take this example you see down here. So I have two different kinds of toppings for my pizza, and I have two different kinds of crusts for my pizza. What I would like to know in this particular example is, does the crust make a difference, and does the toppings make a difference? In other words, is there a main effect for crust, and is there a main effect for topping? And the way I would do that is I would just, first of all, compare the crusts. Regardless of the toppings, I just want to compare the crusts. So I can just, you know, average across the toppings. Then compare the toppings averaging across the crusts. So we're only looking at one factor and completely ignoring the other. And when we do this, it does look like we might have a main effect for crust and a main effect for topping. There does seem to be a difference there in those averages. And that's the basic idea of a main effect. You just want to look to see if one factor all by itself seems to have an influence on the dependent variable. But let me just give you another quick example. Because I'm kind of hungry, let's just keep talking about pizza. Imagine you work for a pizzeria and you decide to give your customers four different kinds of pizza. You want to see which one is the most popular amongst this particular group of customers. So you give one group thin crust with cheese toppings, another group of students you give thin crust with pepperoni, and then another you give thick crust with cheese and thick crust with pepperoni. So we have all four possible combinations of these two different levels for these two factors. So after you measure how much they enjoy each kind of pizza, we can then average across the levels of one of the factors to see if there's a main effect for the other. If we were to do this, and let's just assume that this is the data that we're using here for this example, if we were to do this kind of averaging across, it looks like we would find a main effect. There does seem to be a difference between these different levels or these different factors. So we have found a couple of main effects in this case. But that's not the most interesting thing. The whole point of doing a factorial design isn't to just ignore the other factors and look at each factor individually. The most interesting thing about doing a factorial design is to look at how they combine, how the levels of these factors combine in interesting ways to produce, you know, interesting results. And those results we refer to as interactions. So an interaction between factors can be simply defined as whenever one factor modifies the effects of another. We would call the factors independent if they don't have an interaction. One common example of interactions between factors that I'm sure you've heard of before is drugs. If you've ever seen a drug commercial, you'll hear them talk about how you shouldn't take this drug if you take such and such other drugs because they could interact. Their effects could combine in potentially harmful ways. Like, for example, one drug could exaggerate the effects of another. Or it could do the opposite. It could minimize or block the effects of the other. So just take a look at this fictitious data down here. Cocaine and caffeine are both psychoactive stimulants. They speed up your body and your brain's processing. And if we look at these data, you can see that In both cases, we're getting higher values. We're getting more stimulation. But when they are combined, that stimulation is magnified exponentially, it seems. So when you mix two different psychoactive stimulants together, what you can get in some cases in the real world is this kind of exponential increase in how effective they are. So this is just one little example of how, you know, harmful, but also in some cases very interesting and helpful interactions between factors can be. When it comes to identifying the presence of an interaction, the easiest way to do that is by putting it on a chart. So when you put this data onto a chart as a line graph, what you'll notice is that these lines for these factors, they'll either be parallel or non-parallel. If the lines are parallel, then that means there's no interaction. But if the lines are non-parallel, if they intersect, if they cross at any point, then that indicates that there is an interaction present in the data. Of course, this isn't conclusive. You do need to do statistical analysis to verify that there is, in fact, an interaction here. But typically, when you see crossing lines on a line graph, that indicates there's an interaction between these two factors. So just to give you a little visual example of what I mean, factor one is on the x-axis, and you can see the two levels for factor one. The dependent variable is on the y-axis, and then the two levels of factor two are these two lines you see. So level one and level two cross. And that's exactly what an interaction would look like. Here's just a few more quick examples. So an interaction could look like this, where the lines cross. Or it could look something like this. That's another example. But something that a lot of students get confused on is the lines don't actually have to cross in the chart area. They just have to cross eventually. Like if you were to continue this line out indefinitely, you would see that eventually the two lines will cross. So the lines don't have to physically cross inside the chart area for there to be interaction. And then just to give you an example of a non-interaction, here's what that would look like. So it's pretty easy to identify interactions by looking at figures like this. But when it comes to trying to identify interactions without using any kind of chart like this, it's going to be a little bit trickier. You can still do it. You can identify interactions simply by looking at data in a matrix. What you're basically going to want to do is visually compare the mean differences in one row from the mean differences in other rows. Same goes for columns. So to put it more simply, you just look at how the numbers change in one row and compare that to how the numbers change in the next row. And if that change seems different, you know, if the top row changes more than the bottom row, then that would suggest that there's an interaction present. So you do that for the rows, you do that for the columns, and if you do see that kind of non-constant change over the various levels, you probably have an interaction in the data. As always, you do need to do statistical analysis to be sure, but it's a pretty good, you know, quick way to figure out if there seems to be an interaction in it. But you need to be careful when you attempt to identify main effects and interactions. Keep in mind that each main effect is an average. It may not accurately represent any of the individual effects that were used to compute the average. So what might appear to be an obvious main effect could actually be insignificant. It could be due to chance. This is why we always need to do proper statistical analyses. Also, if you do have an interaction in the data, that can obscure or distort main effects. Like, interactions are the first thing you should always look for because they can have this kind of effect. So always look for interactions first, because if you find one, that could mean any main effects you find later just aren't real. They're just, you know, side effects, so to say. And one final thing, when it comes to main effects and interactions, you need to understand that these things are independent. Researchers are interested in main effects and interactions, but they don't have any real influence on each other. So here's what I'm trying to say. For example, in a two-factor study, researchers would evaluate three separate sets of mean differences. They would look at the mean differences for main effect of factor A, the mean differences for the main effect of factor B, and the mean differences from the interaction. And they could find any one of these. So they could find a main effect for A, but not for B or the interaction. Or they could find a main effect for the interesting mean difference for the interaction, but not the main effects. These things are completely independent of one another. So when you do statistical analysis, you need to check every single one of them to see if they appear to be in the data. But as I said just a moment ago, if you find an interaction, that kind of makes the main effects seem unreliable. So it's always a good idea to do all the statistical analysis. You just need to keep in mind that interactions can distort those main effects.